I invite you to stand for the reading of the gospel. From Mark, the first chapter, beginning in the 35th verse. Early in the morning, well before sunrise, Jesus rose and went to a deserted place where he could be alone in prayer. Simon and those with him tracked him down. When they found him, they told him, "Everyone is looking for you." He replied, "Let's head in the other direction, to the nearby villages, so that I can preach there too. That is why I've come." And Jesus traveled throughout Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and casting out demons. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Will you pray with me? Lord, open our eyes that we might see. Open our ears that we might hear. Open our hearts that we might discover and discern the message that you have for us today. This we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. If your cable movie channels are anything like ours, the 1989 Oscar-winning movie Dead Poets Society is shown regularly. It's an engaging, entertaining, tragic story that takes place in Vermont's Welton Academy, a famous boys' preparatory school. Mr. John Keating was a new faculty member who had returned to his alma mater to teach literature to the young men of Welton. Because of his intimate familiarity with all the traditions and values of the school, Mr. Keating added a rather colorful perspective to changing or challenging his students to think outside of their rather comfortable and protected environment. Mr. Keating had a goal. That goal was to prepare the young men for life beyond Welton Academy. For the most part, the students responded positively to Mr. Keating. But there were other faculty members, as well as some of the parents, who were opposed to both the teaching methods as well as the content of what Mr. Keating was teaching. Probably the most famous line from the movie was a line that was shared by Mr. Keating to his students. "Carpe diem, lads," is what he would say. "Carpe diem. Seize the day. Make your lives extraordinary. Make the most of this present moment." Now, it seems to me that all of us need to be reminded regularly that living today is a unique and special gift that we have been given. We need to be reminded that we have no guarantees about tomorrow. Life is fragile. Accidents, illness, tragedy happen unexpectedly. Life can be amazingly temporary. Consequently, we need to live today with a zest and a zeal that makes the most of our time. We've learned from yesterday. We hope for tomorrow. But in between yesterday and tomorrow is today, and we must make it extraordinary. I believe that all of us want to make a difference. We want to leave a positive mark upon the world that affirms that we did more than merely breathe in and breathe out. We want to matter. We want to invest ourselves so that the world is better because we have been a part of it. Nobody ever sets out to be insignificant. Nobody has an initial goal to be mediocre. We all want to excel. We all want to make a difference. So it seems to me that all of us want to seize the day. We're simply unsure how to make that kind of quality exist in our lives. Do you ever wonder if Jesus had self-identity issues? Do you ever think he was perplexed about who he was or struggled to discover his purpose in life? Do you think Jesus ever asked the questions that you and I ask almost regularly? Why am I here? What role do I play? What did God create me to be or to do? Do you think he struggled like we do? The gospel writer Mark gave us an unusual glimpse of Jesus that was similar and yet different from the perspectives of Matthew or Luke. When we read and study the very first chapter of Mark, we discover that Mark began his gospel with the baptism of Jesus. Mark actually bypassed all the preparatory stories in order to dive into the significance of Jesus' ministry. Mark had a compelling urgency in the way he told the stories of Jesus. In fact, his favorite word was immediately. And immediately, coming up out of the water, Jesus saw the heavens open and the Spirit of God descending like a dove. And immediately, the Spirit led Jesus into the wilderness. Jesus said to Simon and Andrew, "Follow me," and immediately they left their nets and followed him. Then Jesus saw James and John, and immediately he called them. And they went to Capernaum, and immediately Jesus entered the synagogue and began to teach. And immediately the news about Jesus traveled throughout the district of Galilee. Now Simon's mother-in-law was sick, and immediately the family shared their concern with Jesus. And all of those phrases that I just read to you are found in the first chapter alone of the book of Mark. When you read Mark's gospel, there was no time for the trivial. Every story had purpose. Every teaching and every action of Jesus was connected to every other teaching and action of Jesus. When we look through the lens of Mark, there was an urgency about both the private and the professional life of Jesus that we do not glean when we read the other gospels. Now back to the story. According to Mark, after Jesus had spent the day teaching and preaching and healing in the home of Simon's mother-in-law, the next morning, Jesus got up early to find a place for solitude and prayer. Now please, friends, do not minimize the importance of that piece of information. Early in the morning, he found a place for solitude and prayer. You see, Jesus found it necessary to get away from the urgent, to spend time doing what was important. He needed time alone. He needed time to think. He needed time to listen and to talk with God. He needed time to discern God's direction for his life. Jesus was engaged in life. He invested in life, and yet still he needed time for prayer. He was a busy person, if you will. But worship and prayer was a priority for him. And out of his time of prayer came even greater understanding of both himself and his purpose. So, my friends, if we want to seize the day, if we really want to seize the day, it begins with prayer. If prayer was important for Jesus, then it ought to be important for us. Now notice the way Mark developed the story. When Jesus was praying alone, Simon and his companions went to look for him. They tracked him down. That's the way the Common English Bible phrases it. They tracked him down. And when they found him, they said, "Everybody's looking for you." Simon and his colleagues had an agenda. They had expectations of Jesus, and apparently everybody in that community did too. They were demanding enough that they wanted Jesus to do what they wanted him to do when they wanted him to do it. How many times do you and I find ourselves doing what is expected of us? We all live with the tension of expectations, don't we? Sometimes there's actually a collision that occurs between our personal values and desires and our own personal expectations when it butts up against the expectations of others. And then when we superimpose what we believe to be God's expectations, why, it's the equation for internal and external tension and conflict. Did you notice how Jesus dealt with the situation? He set a boundary. He set a boundary. He said, "I understand what you're saying. I understand what you're asking of me. I understand what the people are desiring from me. But in spite of those expectations, I need to be true to myself and my calling. I need to go in another direction," he said. "People in other villages are important too. I need to proclaim the good news." If there ever was an example of someone who knew how to seize the day, it was Jesus. In prayer and through prayer, Jesus continued to learn about what he believed to be his purpose and mission in life. Jesus invested himself with a sense of urgency to do what God created him to do. And who among us cannot learn something valuable from that lesson? I think as individuals, we need to take this kind of lesson to heart. We need to learn from the one that we call Lord. The example of Jesus, I believe, is the best example in teaching us how to live with purpose and meaning. But I also believe it is a powerful lesson for the community of faith. As a congregation, we too need to seize the day. There are needs, there are opportunities, there are challenges unlike any day in the history of the world. And if you do not believe that, review the news over the last 15 days. We have heard, haven't we? We have heard with disturbing clarity how ideological differences in our communities and in our country and around the world are eroding our ability to even listen to one another, let alone to make good and responsible decisions. It's easy, my friends, it's easy to get sucked into the anger and the fear and the upset that is permeating our world. But I tell you, friends, Christ, as Christ followers, we are called to a higher standard of living. We must seize the day. Values and morality and ethics are being eroded right before our very eyes. And the only way to counterbalance the crisis is to live according to the example of Jesus. It is a complex time. It's a complex world. It's confusing. It's not easy to understand the times or the seasons. It's not easy to develop a faith that will hold us steady, steady enough to trust God and ask for wisdom and guidance to face our challenges. If I've said it once, I've said it dozens of times from this very pulpit. God has placed you and I in this world for such a time as this. There is no escape of that reality. And God has given us all the faith and all the resources that we need to meet our challenges and to positively influence our world. And yet, in order for us to seize the day that God has given to us, we too must spend our time in prayer, asking God for wisdom and guidance and courage. We dare not be susceptible to living into the expectations of others when they are opposed to the values that are uniquely Christian. We must be self-defined, self-assured enough to say with clarity and conviction, this is the way we need to go. And we must follow what we believe is God's direction. I believe that's our highest calling. I believe it is our greatest responsibility. And I think that's the reason why. That's the reason why the call of God through the prophet Isaiah continues to be so relevant for us today. So I want you to hear it again. Don't you know? Haven't you heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not grow weary or tired. His understanding is beyond human reach, giving power to the tired and reviving the exhausted. Young people will become tired and weary. Young men and women will stumble. Those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will fly up on wings like eagles. They will run and not be tired. They will not grow weary. Seize the day. That is our call. Seize the day. Amen. Thank you for being with us this morning. We trust that God has spoken to you through something that has been done in the course of our time of worship. Rejoice. What a wonderful way to leave worship. Rejoice, give thanks, and sing. You see, all of us have opportunity. They are unique opportunities. Your opportunity is not like mine, and mine is not like yours. We are all unique. We've all been created in the image of God. We've all been called. We've all been given a job to do. So seize the day. Take advantage of who you are and what opportunities are before you to make a difference in the world. Go with God.